podcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Audio bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by Winamp. Subscribe to TWiT and all your favorite podcasts with the ultimate media player. Download it for free at winamp.com. Video bandwidth for TWiT is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT, This Week in Tech, episode 265, recorded September 12th, 2010, Passing the Stone. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Audible.com. Sign up for the Platinum Plan and get two free books. Go to audible.com/twit2 and don't forget to follow Audible on Twitter. User ID audible_com. And by squarespace.com, the fast and easy way to publish a high-quality website or blog. For a free trial and 10% off your new account, go to squarespace.com/twit. And by Ford and the new Ford Fiesta. With an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon, no other compact car is more fuel efficient. Plus, 15 other features offered by no other vehicle in its class. That's the 2011 Ford Fiesta. Drive one at a Ford dealer near you. It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech, the show that covers the latest tech news, and this time we're doing a special edition. It's a very special This Week in Tech, because joining me are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and perhaps 6 later on in the show, of the original TWiT hosts. The only one missing at this point is Kevin Rose. I'll start from my left, Mr. Roger Chang.
Hello.
Who is still a very welcome part of the family. He does East Meets West with Tom Merritt every Sunday, right after TWiT. Are you going to do it after this show?
Yes.
Tom will stop by?
Hope so.
I think everybody on this show worked at Tech TV, too.
Yes.
And now you all work at Revision 3.
Except for you.
And John.
And John.
John, and do you do a show at the Revision 3?
I do contract work.
Okay.
Seems unlikely.
Future is murky. That other voice we're hearing, of course, the great, the inimitable Mr. Patrick Norton from the Screensavers and TechZilla.com. Good to see you, Patrick.
Good to be here.
This all started because I sent out an email by accident that was a response to an email from TWiT14, and you all answered.
Which would have been, what, 5 years ago?
Yeah, it was like 5 years ago. Wait a minute.
It's a 2005 email, yep.
I hear a voice in my ear. Is Yoshi, are you there?
I am. I just pulled over, actually.
Oh, my God.
OMG.
Oh, my God. Ladies and gentlemen, Yoshi DeHerrera.
Hey, guys.
The famous Yoshi, who dropped off the face of the earth after about TWiT14. I think it was right around then. We're so glad to hear from you, Yoshi. Let me introduce everybody else, then I want to talk to you, because I know you're on a short break.
Actually, I'm pulled off on the side of I-75, so I got a little time.
Nothing to do until somebody rear-ends you.
Yeah.
So great to hear from you, Yoshi.
In Los Angeles, that can happen at any time.
I know, really. You don't want to mess around with that. That's John C. Dvorak from Channel Dvorak. And I think the only one of you who continues on a regular basis to be part of TWiT. But all of you have appeared on TWiT since then, except for Yoshi, I think. So it's really great to see you, John.
Good to be here, Leo.
I have to do all sorts of weird switching to get everybody in here. That's, my God, Robert Heron of HD Nation. Haven't seen Robert in ages. Good to see you again.
Thank you. Good to be here.
And let me press one more button and bring in David Prager, who looks like he's at work. What are you doing at work?
I was having some computer issues, so I decided I'd just go and grab another computer.
It's great to see you.
And I happen to live about a block and a half from here.
So welcome back to all of you. It's so great to see you. Everybody should now check in on Facebook Places. There'll be this massive interconnective tissue. So, David, I think that you said the reason Kevin couldn't make it is he's meeting with a new CEO of Dig. He finally has somebody.
I'm pretty sure that's what he's doing. I think that's what he told me he was doing today, or a good part of the day today. He's already started.
This is why Twitter's bad, because I know for a fact that he's watching football.
Is that what he said? Is that what he's been tweeting out?
Yeah. He's watching football. Yeah. Maybe he's watching it with the new CEO of Dig.
Yeah.
I know that he's really happy. So, Yoshi, just to have a CEO, because I know it was a burden for him to run that thing. Yoshi, what have you been doing since we saw you last?
Well, I'm actually, when I was at TWiT, I just started the last TWiT that I was on. I think I just started working for the company I'm on, doing the visual effects work and the scanning.
And you got married and you had a baby.
Yeah.
All at once.
Still married. And Cruz is actually, he's getting big, starting kindergarten on Monday.
Wow. You're kidding. So Cruz is six now?
He's five. He's going to be five in October.
Holy cow.
He's a big one.
So, no, I never begrudged it because I knew that you had quite a few things going on. So, is it okay to say what movie you're working on right now?
Yeah, well, right now, actually, I'm driving back to Atlanta. But I'm in Atlanta, and we're doing a little work on Fast and the Furious 5.
That's exciting. Everybody's all excited. Tony Wang was jumping up and down when he heard that there's going to be a fifth. So was Patrick. So, Yoshi, what do you do in the special effects biz?
Well, basically what we do is we come in and they have us scan or, you know, 3D digitized sets, actors, cars, props, maquettes, pretty much anything they want made 3D.
So, because when you were at the Screensavers, you did a lot with that laser cutter.
Yeah.
And you did a lot of course, mod work. So this kind of segue into what you're doing now?
Oh, definitely. I mean, you know, I've had to kind of make our own little tools to get things done, and that's helped a lot.
Sounds like a great job for you.
Oh, it's a blast. It's a blast. We get to go from project to project, and I think I'm up to about 70 movies so far. So.
Holy cow. That's fantastic.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
And I see pictures of you on my Facebook. You're looking good. You're obviously doing well.
Yeah, you know, I've pumped back up a little bit, unfortunately. It's a...
So have I, Yoshi.
It's not too good for the old exercise level. So unfortunately, the standard day is about 12 hours.
And the craft table is no help either.
No, craft services does not help. Neither does the catering on set.
Oh, look, Oreos.
Oh, some of the catering is amazing. One of them had a nice little lamb shoulder and a duck fat confit. It was out of this world, but probably not too good for me.
Oh, man. So... any fun stories from your Hollywood time?
It's hard to say. There's so many little stories. I mean, I guess the biggest thing I would say that I've discovered is most of the people we work with are pretty cool and kind of like regular people.
Do you get to drive the cars at all in Fast and Furious? That would be fun.
No.
That would be fun.
I could move them across the warehouse when I got to scan one of them, but that's about it.
Well, if you saw the video of me crashing the Ford Flex into the Ford Fiesta, you know that you never want to let me get behind the wheel at all. So, Yoshi, we're so pleased to know you're alive and well and thriving, and it's great to hear from you. If you want to stick around, we'd love to have you stick around, but I'm just pleased that you could... call in and say hi to everybody. And I know I'm just seeing everybody in the chat room going crazy. That they're just so pleased to see you and hear from you.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Love to stick around for a little bit.
Fantastic.
I've pulled off, sitting in a gas station. I'm all good.
By the side of the road. Yoshi's by the side of the road. It's a good thing you're not on Skype because I pretty much run out of room here. I have to manually switch to pull up people. So, John, I will defer to you, but story number one, GoDaddy goes on the auction block, according to the Wall Street Journal on Friday. GoDaddy, not my favorite domain name registrar in the world, apparently, according to the Wall Street Journal, makes about, what was it they said?
$700-800 million.
A year. 700, 800. How do you make $700 or $800 million a year selling
revenue or volume?
Do you remember the dark days of network solutions and getting charged a bazillion dollars every year for your URL? GoDaddy comes in, they take advantage.
I guess it's all profit.
Unprecedented low prices,
even $10. Well, don't they have to pay ICANN or somebody something?
Nonetheless, it's they have a ton of customers, including me.
Yeah, I was a GoDaddy customer, but I got I hated the. It wasn't so much the ads, it was the cheesy, come on, you want to see the rest, boys? Go to the website.
I've never actually seen one of the television advertisements.
The Danica?
They are an advertiser on Techzilla.
We love GoDaddy. Yeah, use the Techzilla GoDaddy code. What is the code?
Tech4.
Revision3.com/GoDaddy.
Of course, Prager knows.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I actually met one of the guys.
And they support Cranky Geeks as well.
They're good people, right, John C. Dvorak?
Yeah, use the code CRANK, CRANK.
This episode of Not Being Objective in News Discussion is brought to you by Leo Laporte, Standing Alone.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm kind of stunned. They say that GoDaddy could fetch more than $1 billion.
A billion.
Frank Quattrone's group, Catalyst Partners, is overseeing the sale. They're the ones who got so much money for 3PAR from Hewlett-Packard in that bidding war. Who was it? Hewlett-Packard was bidding against, who was it, Oracle for 3PAR? I can't remember.
Dell.
That's right. It went up and up and up. The last domain firm that was sold, I think, was register.com, $130 million. So
I don't understand
billion.
Why they're not doing an initial public offering instead of this. Like, none of these, like register.com network solutions, none of those are private are publicly traded.
John? Well, Sarbanes-Oxley, that's the reason.
Really?
What is SOX? No,
it's
sorry.
It's the most onerous law ever put in play.
That was the Jeopardy answer. What are SOX? What is SOX?
It's the most onerous initiative ever enacted by Congress, done around 2002. It's designed to protect bookkeepers from liability to the extent that it puts all the onus on the CEOs and all the people that are running companies to do all the work that the public accountants used to do. And they have to sign off on everything. And if anything bad happens, they get thrown in jail.
It was a response
to this and that.
To the
it's
Enron
a mess.
Yeah.
This is why we have no IPOs. This is why the economy's in the dumper. This is why we've got no small tech companies getting public money.
Well, wait a minute, though. Isn't Facebook saying we're going to go public in 2011?
Zuckerberg has said that Facebook isn't going public anytime soon.
Really?
I do you really think? I mean, explain to me why Sarbanes-Oxley is crushing.
Because if you don't go public, you don't have to adhere to these accounting rules. Is that right,
John? No, that's not what it is. The real reason is because just for compliance alone, it's been estimated that 4% of your profits are gone from compliance. To comply with this law, so only the largest companies can actually afford to
this
stay
is why
public.
Market should be unregulated because Americans can protect themselves and the market marks. I mean is this basically a classic like unregulate everything and if you know if
no,
you're,
no,
if
no,
you're
I,
stupid well, enough to work for a company
see,
that
I,
forces
I,
you to buy the
no,
company
no,
stock
no. You're missing the whole point. This came out after MCI and the scammers
WorldCom. Yeah.
They put this in play, and if you really look at it carefully, it doesn't do anything about it. You know, MCI would have still gone down the same path, and Madoff would still be in business. It doesn't do anything but put a big burden on, and if you talk to a venture capitalist about this, any company making less than $400 million a year cannot afford to be a public company because of Sarbanes-Oxley. Look it up. But check it out. Nobody thinks this is a good thing. It's got nothing to do with deregulation. It was thrown in by the Bush administration to sink the country.
Okay, there we go. And actually, I think there has been a move to kind of soften Sarbanes-Oxley.
Soften, eradicate it.
Yeah. But I have to say, there have been IPOs. There have been some IPOs this year. And I don't know. I think Facebook's headed towards an IPO. If for one reason only. I mean, I'm sure they don't like the regulations that they're going to have to put up with. And there's a lot of them a public company has to put up
move.
With. But there's one reason to do that, and that's because... What is the value nowadays? The way you get engineering talent is with options. And the best way to have options is to have a market, a public market. Well,
I mean, that's the thing, right?
Can you pay them well enough?
Microsoft, well, that's the question, right? The Microsoft lesson is at some point you can't drag stock options in front of people because you can't keep driving the price of stock up enough.
Exactly. And I'm going to tell you that's what's wrong with the tech industry right now. I've just got a proposal. I'll let you guys tell me where I'm wrong here. But I think this is exactly why, for instance, Google had to launch this silly Google Instant this week, this new form of search, right? Because the stock market rewards companies that grow only if they grow at 25% a year. They have to grow at least in the tech sector, they have to grow at an insane rate. Microsoft stopped growing at that rate. Its stock has been flat for years, which means they can no longer attract the best talent because they don't have stock options that are going to inflate every year.
Well, the best
so everybody went to Google's. Google does an IPO, right? Google's stock goes up and up and up. Now Google's flat because no one can grow at 25% a year. And Google's losing people to Facebook. And that's why Facebook ultimately has to do an IPO because they are attracting all the talent. In fact, Google just lost another big name to Facebook. It's happening all the time. In fact, yesterday, A Stanford kid writes something he calls YouTube Instant.
Right.
It's the same kind of search for YouTube that Google's doing. Chad Hurley at Google/YouTube, the CEO of YouTube, tweets him saying, nice stuff. You need a job? The kid
ready
says,
ready to leave school.
Ready to leave. Well, for the kid says, Farah says, is that a serious offer? And Chad says, are you ready to leave school? DM me. Presumably, Google's offering this kid a job. Why? Not because YouTube Instant is so great, because you got to get these guys before they figure out the whole stock option thing and go to Facebook.
Or you create an environment where you have a bunch of smart people and intelligent management
doesn't
decisions.
Work.
And
doesn't work. Isn't Google like that?
I don't. So one guy leaves Google, therefore Google is
screwed? Hundreds have left Google. Google's got a major brain drain to Facebook.
Everybody has major. People get bored. Programmers are like ADD half the time.
John, help me out here. Isn't that really what's going on? Is that if they can't offer valuable stock options, they can't keep these kids who just want money?
You know, I actually, I'm in agreement with you in theory, and in from 10 years ago, I would say yeah, absolutely. But that train's left as far as I'm concerned. I think guys now are just looking for any job that has some security. But we're also talking about the millennials who
I'm talking about the best. No, you're right when it's talking about everybody. But I'm talking about the best and the brightest, the whatever it is, the 100 great engineers graduating each year from Stanford and MIT and Cal Poly.
If Sarbanes-Oxley was gone, we would have all these little companies.
Nice job, John, for the win. Brings it back to socks. Well,
I don't know. I mean, I have a bunch of friends who went to school. One of them just sold his company just sold for $20 million to Motorola. Another one is a pretty
just
amazing
got out of
security
school?
Start. Well, I mean, they got out of school like, you know, 5-7 years ago now, but
that's amazing.
A lot of the guys getting out of school today, and women for that matter, are basically coming up with the right idea, getting together a crew of people they trust and starting their own company.
Yeah.
You know,
hey, this is a good time to be entrepreneurial as opposed to going to work for a big corporation. So maybe that's the problem.
It's always a good time to be entrepreneurial.
Was there not a flow of the best minds from Microsoft to Google and now from Google to Facebook? Is that not happening?
You know, maybe they were just looking for that environment that they encountered the first time around. They want
somewhere cool and exciting and growing.
You know, I mean, there's a certain amount of energy and vitality when you get to when you're given... No, essentially the keys.
I'm at a new small place, or I'm going to do this. Or you know what also is? It's free agency, too.
Right.
Wow,
how much
agency.
Will you pay? How much will you pay me? You know, John, look, we've lost John. We've lost
Wait
Aaron.
A minute. Will
Prager's
there be...
like darning socks.
All right, John, what is it? What is it out of your melon that you want to say?
Nothing. I'm listening to this bull crap.
So to go back to the original question, John, so they're going to take the big check from a holding company at GoDaddy instead of going for an IPO, and that's entirely due to Sarbanes-Oxley, or because it's easier, or is because it's faster, easier, and simpler,
and they might make more money.
Yeah,
I'm a billion. In fact, some are saying a billion. That's the starting point. They're going to get 1.4. I mean, if it's a multiple of 800 million
well, you know,
a year.
I've always thought Bob Parsons was a good guy anyway.
Really? Do you like Bob?
Well, you know, he used to do this thing called Rat Pack or something like that back in the day. He was one of the first guys who had these personal organizing software systems.
I'm going to have to rethink. Oh, he did Rat Pack. I remember that.
Yeah, it was some crazy thing. Yeah, it was like he was always calling everybody in all the magazines, and he was really a nice guy. He was down in San Diego, I believe.
Well, he's now in Scottsdale. I'll give you, I have had bad thoughts about GoDaddy for a couple of reasons. One is all the upsell stuff. That's why they make $800 million. It's not on the $9.95. It's the 15 different offers that you take. To get out of that hell, the checkout hell there, and that always bugged me. I always bugged me the sexy ads with the come to the website and see Danica.
Kind of like the sexy
down.
Ads. And Bob's an old guy, so he's an old horn dog. So he ran all these
that's
ads.
Pretty much the feeling I get from it. That's all. All right. No, you guys aren't going to say anything bad about him, so I'm not going to say anything bad about him. Bob, I love you. You're beautiful. Don't ever change.
Oh, you should have invited him on, actually, to talk about it. I bet you would have done it. He's got his own show every week that
he keeps calling me. He keeps calling me, yeah.
Does he?
Well, he called me once. Keeps is probably a little strong. He called me once. He wanted to talk because I've been pretty hard on him.
I've always liked the guy.
All right. So I'm going to rethink because I like you, John, and if you like him, he can only be half bad.
I love the videos he does on his website, though. His weekly podcast is pretty cool as far as business. He gives some valuable information about people trying to start their businesses and stuff. Going to the whole sexy commercial thing, my only complaint really is that he says go to the commercial to see the unrated version.
Right.
The unrated version is essentially what they just showed on
TV. It's the same thing. It's such a cheesy. It's cheesy. And how would you know that, Leo? Well,
no free porn.
Research. There's no free porn. It was pure research.
Leo took the hit for the team.
All right. We're going to talk in just a second about
busted.
Hey, I like porn. Who doesn't like porn? Okay, I'm going to come out on this one because this is the dirty little secret of the internet.
Is you like porn?
No, 90% of internet traffic's porn.
90?
Without
90% of internet traffic depending on which week you see.
I'm sorry. 90% of internet traffic is peer-to-peer file sharing.
I thought it was
of porn movies.
But it's in the last 3 years, 90% of the internet traffic has either been spam, video,
that's
pornography,
nobody
or BitTorrent, depending on which BSPR report is trying to convince congressman of what.
It's the fact that dare not speak its name.
Pornography?
You
know, after a while, all those sites kind of look the same, don't they? Every time you see the little banner.
You've seen one, you've seen them all.
Well, based on all the junk email and banners I see floating around.
All right, I'm going to talk about something much more interesting.
More interesting than porn?
One of the hottest. Yes, apparently, according to some.
All right.
One of the hottest properties out there right now. There was a very interesting expose. I think it was in SF Weekly. Their motto, the guy in the former employee, the disgruntled former employee says, is do evil. Do evil. We'll talk about that in just a second. But Yoshi, ever get to drive any great Ford Fiestas when you're in that and out there in that? What are you laughing at? I love the Ford Fiesta.
Actually, it's a fun car to drive.
It's cute.
Yes, I remember when that CHP officer looked over his shoulder and shook his head at you.
I wasn't doing anything.
I got to sit in a fun Ford, but it wasn't a Fiesta.
What Ford was that?
GT40.
Oh. Nice. I drive a GT, a 2010 GT, and I'm looking at the 5.0, but there's that Shelby. It is so beautiful. Such a sweet car. Now, see, that's made for drifting. That's made for drifting.
I think you're talking about the Ford
that
used to run.
What's the GT40? What's that?
That's the one that used the not the replica, but the update to the car that that used to run the Le Mans, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, so I should never get in a conversation with car buffs. Oh, that's sweet. Is it a Mustang?
No.
What is it?
It's
a GT. Yeah, it's a GT. Although I did hear there were some issues with the transaxle. Oh, does it have a transaxle? I don't remember. There were some issues with it cracking or something.
I should never get in a conversation with a guy who reads Jane's Auto Monthly.
They don't have it.
I saw one of those things floating around San Francisco a couple weeks ago.
That's a nice looking car Patrick's showing me right now. Yeah. Oh, that's sweet.
It's a nice car.
Well, okay. Many of us would like to drive a car like that but can't afford it. Perhaps you'd like a car that gets 40 miles to the gallon highway. How about that? According to EPA estimates. Maybe you'd prefer that. Maybe you'd like a car that's comfy, fun to drive, and affordable. Maybe you would like a Ford Fiesta. And you know one of the best parts of the Ford Fiesta? It's got that great Ford sink. I cleaned up the kit. What are you looking at me like that, Roger?
Yeah. I'm not looking at you.
Have you ever tried the Ford sink?
Yeah, no, I think it's great. I used it in the Lincoln, and I used it
there
in
you go.
The,
yeah. Okay, yeah. Ford, Lincoln, and Mercury vehicles. I got it. Yeah. I was in the other day. I was driving the old car, you know, the Lexus I used to drive, because the kids have that right now.
Kids have the Lexus.
It's 10 years old. But I was really missing the sink because I get in the car. I've got my Android phone. It reads me text messages. You know, when text messages come in, it reads me the text messages.
Nice.
It's got pre-programmed responses. The idea is you never take your hands off the wheel or your eyes off the road.
You don't even have to take the keys out of your pocket to open the door.
It's so sweet. Yeah.
When zombies attack, it's a benefit.
Yeah, you saw that
yes.
That viral ad they did. That was so funny. Yeah, you just get in. The capless fuel system, I love that. Power shift, 6-speed automatic transmission. There's options like heated leather trim seats. I mean, this is not, you're not giving up a lot. That 1.6-liter Duratec TIVCT I4 engine. Did I say that right, Patrick?
Yes.
The easy fuel capless fuel filter. I'm reading crap. I don't know what the hell it is. A 4-inch multifunctional display with LCD screen. And responsive and nimble performance. I know about that. It's all in your Ford Fiesta at your local Ford dealer.
If you look at the video that they did on Top Gear with the Fiesta,
did they like it?
Like cornering inside of a mall, being chased by a Corvette, and it'll beat it because it can corner 10 times better than the Corvette was able to. And then they did a beach landing, where they had the Ford Fiesta land on the beach as if they're storming the beach. It was pretty one of the most amazing Top Gear spots I've ever seen, with featuring the Fiesta. Show. And I was almost certain they sponsored it, but I think they were just decided to make that make the spot that entertaining. And it was basically a fluff piece for the Fiesta, but just because the darn car handles that well.
It's fun. They brought one over, and I drove it around. It's just really fun. I want you to take a look at it. All the Fords, all the Lincolns, all the Mercurys, because you really want that Ford sync. And I think the Ford Fiesta is fantastic. Drive one this week at a Ford dealer near you. We thank them for their support of this week in tech. And there it is. See, I thought, because that's the GT Mustang. I thought that's what you're talking about, Yoshi. That's fun, though. Will you, Yoshi, will you come out here and teach me how to drift?
Sure. We get to use your car, right, Leo?
Yeah, we'll use my car.
You use the Lexus that you gave your kids.
You can't. It's front-wheel drive. When we went out in on the test track at Ford, they had the new 2011 Shelby, and the guy took me out. And he was like, I mean, he practically had the thing spinning around. I mean, it was amazing. Yeah. I threw up a couple of times, but that's okay.
Your Lexus is front-wheel drive?
Isn't it?
No. What model do you have?
Oh, I thought it was. Shows no. What I know.
Well, the low end is basically an up...
I have a GS... I had a GS300 2001. 2001.
Is Henry driving it?
He will if he ever gets a license. 16 years old and he doesn't have a license. It's
I
like
can get my license until I was 18.
That's these kids today.
Kids today? I swear to God.
Riding their bicycles and... converting cars to biodiesel.
Saving the environment, all that crap.
Oh, good for him.
What's wrong with them?
Whoa, Leo. Whoa.
They're just a reflection of their parents.
No, I don't know why, but Henry, my daughter, you know, the minute she was 15 and a half, learner's permit, driving.
Give me the keys.
And so that's the car she drove. And then Henry, that's, you know, she's gone. She's at college, so that's the car he drove. So did you see this article about Farmville? A couple of interesting things. First of all, the expose with the former Farmville employee who said basically Zynga steals any game they can. The goal is don't worry about originality. Just worry about hooking our users. They've been sued before. If they were sued over Mafia Wars, Farmville's the one that everybody's playing, not only on Facebook, but now they have it on, I think, it's an app for iOS. So there's this secret thing. Gawker revealed this. Ryan Tate writing for Gawker. Called the Platinum Purchase Program for Zynga. Normally in Farmville, you can only buy about $200 worth of whatever those points are called that allow you to build the pony barn and stuff like that. They're spending real money for digital, you know, goods. But they have a special Platinum Purchase Program which allows you of a minimum purchase of $500. You have to use wire transfer. You can't use a credit card. You get extra points. If you fur a friend, you get more points. And there are apparently, and nobody's talking about this, people are spending thousands of dollars a month on little pony points. Obsessive gaming junkies, many of them underaged or low income. New York Times discovered an unemployed disabled guy was spending 16 hours a day on Yoville, another one of the Zynga properties. And according to this disillusioned ex-employee, Mark Pincus, the CEO, has a predatory attitude towards gamers, has told his programmers that pumping up profits is more important than the actual play, and that our motto is unofficially do evil.
And the problem is?
Yeah, it's like, I like it.
Sucker these people and take their money.
Take
man.
Their money. I mean,
please, they're begging it.
Really? Is it okay, Robert?
Is buying pony points?
Is it okay though that this is, you know, and I have to say this is kind of the problem a little bit I have with Facebook too. It feels more like a compulsion than an actual enjoyable thing. Zynga's games, according to this SF Weekly article, are built around a compulsion loop.
Yep.
Yes. All video games
yes.
are built around
it. Well, all
slot
are...
machines are built around a compulsion loop. Shopping is built around a compulsion loop. Credit cards are built around a compulsion
TWiT
loop.
TWiT is built around a compulsion loop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was also pointing
is
out
it
that,
really?
That the it was the disgruntled former employee said yeah. that Zynga's motto was do evil.
Right.
Zynga,
yeah, my high-paying game developer contract, I didn't want to renew it again and just receive all that money to develop these relatively simple but addictive games.
So you guys, do you play Farmville? Robert?
No.
Yoshi, you play any Farmville?
No.
No. Do you spend any time on Facebook at all? I think Carrie...
Oh, I spend a lot of time on Facebook. I don't play Farmville or Yoville or I do play a lot of Words with Friends. That's my one.
I love Words with Friends. Can I play with you?
Yeah.
What's your handle?
Yoshi.
Oh, I should be able to find that. Cool. I love Words with Friends. That's the Scrabble clone. That's not.
Yeah.
It's not cool. Supposed to be Scrabble, but it is.
Because I used to play Scrabulous all the time until they got.
It's like Scrabulous.
You should play Chess with Friends.
Zynga has Chess with. Oh, no. There is Chess with Friends. I do play that, yeah.
It's made by the same people that do the Words with Friends.
Yeah, it's. I'm
trying to think their names.
I don't know the name of the company.
Yeah. TWiTville. What if we had a TWiTville and you could be there and you and you and you there? We could make so much money.
But what would we be selling?
You know, the gold-plated microphone would really fit.
Gold-plated microphone?
Evil motto.
Yeah. Oh. See, I'm just missing the
boat. Somebody get Laporte a cat to pet.
I'm not cynical enough, apparently.
You're not ambitious enough.
Evil. Here's Dr. Evil. Court upholds EULA's threatens digital resale. What a shocker this was. Tom Merritt talked about it on Tech News Today. U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit, which is, you know, a pretty activist. This is the Northern California Court of Appeals and traditionally kind of liberal activist. They ruled on a longstanding case involving used software on eBay. The issue is, of course, these shrink wrap agreements that say you don't own the program. You just buy the right to use it, which means, of course, you can't resell it.
Well, okay, part of the backstory on this, a guy buys some used copies of I want to say, AutoCAD.
AutoCAD it was, yes.
The AutoCAD copies were sold, part of the agreement.
He bought the serial numbers, he bought the media.
But the people he bought them from, part of their agreement with Autodesk was that the copies would be destroyed, they would not be resold.
Right.
I don't know if that was on a shrink wrap EULA or if that was on an official corporate you know what I mean? Like an actual negotiated contract. The guy goes to sell them on eBay. Autodesk files a complaint. eBay kills the auction. He throws them up on eBay again. eBay, instead of killing the auction, basically, shuts down his account. And then he goes and fires up the lawsuit.
Actually, this guy was on the verge of being banned from eBay. So he sued Autodesk, asking the courts to say, I have the right to sell this AutoCAD software. Federal court, in fact, in 2008 said, yeah, you do have the right to sell. Autodesk appealed, and now the Ninth Circuit ruling on that said no. In fact, that's a legal license. In fact, they said we don't even have a choice. We have to rule this way. We don't want to rule this way because we know it's going to kill the aftermarket for resale. The judges said there's a test. We hold today that a software user is a licensee rather than an owner of a copy where the copyright owner, in this case Autodesk, one, specifies that the user is granted a license, two, significantly restricts the user's ability to transfer the software, and three, imposes notable use restrictions. And AutoCAD did all of that. In fact, you couldn't even transfer the disks out of the Western Hemisphere,
according
to the license agreement. So apparently, I didn't know this, but Amazon's MP3 music store also says that you don't own this. The music that you buy on the MP3 store, Amazon says you will not redistribute, transmit, assign, sell, broadcast, rent, share, lend, modify, adapt, edit, license, or otherwise use digital content.
Well, that's always been the record industry's dream, that when you wanted to get rid of a CD, you would have to ship it back to the company. They could shred it and sell a fresh new CD instead of there being a used CD market. And that's part of the nightmare of peer-to-peer trading for copyright holders. But I mean,
would kill, by the way, libraries, because you couldn't.
The Librarian of Congress gets to write things. The libraries can get around this. Everybody else, it's much more problematic.
The American Library Association is very concerned because they say publishers could forbid lending and licenses. These licenses are upheld.
Well, that's what's really interesting is the idea that, you know, insert name of record company here or insert name of book publishing company, all they have to do is print a bogus EULA, which you probably can't even get to until you've ripped the shrink wrap off the CD, right?
Because
as soon as you see, you know, as soon as you walk into like Barnes & Noble or something, you're going to walk
you're going to
see the book. It's going to be shrink wrapped.
Right.
There's going to be a EULA inside that says you have to send them $100 if you read page one. You know what I mean? It sounds really ridiculous, but it's a really interesting idea that all of a sudden, because software companies, they print ridiculous terms in licensing and they have forever.
Yeah, they do it because they figure why not?
You know, maybe it'll be useful someday right. in court.
And it was.
In this particular case. Now the idea is like, okay, what if the record companies follow suit? What if the gaming companies follow
suit? What if
suit?
Book what publishers? If,
yeah.
Well, gaming companies, yeah.
And it'll be interesting to see whether or not this one gets fought up to the Supreme Court. John, you think it is? Robert? Prager?
I can't imagine that this poor guy, I mean, the guy who's this paying for this is just some eBay.
I think it's
going to
go higher up in the court system because I think that the way they're interpreting the laws are going to, it's going to, I think there's just too much of an argument that's going to be made based on what law they're trying to defend here that allows someone who owns something from either getting a refund for it or being able to liquidate it. I don't think
this is all about the attack on our civil liberties.
I agree, and Sarbanes-Oxley.
No, I'm not going to get back into that. Somebody, they're already giving me a bad time in the chat room. But let's go over one thing that's kind of interesting.
It is about civil liberties. It's a question of do you own something that you bought?
It's property rights. It's civil property rights. And in fact, we're getting laws and we're getting decisions by these courts, for example, that in the case, and I'll ask this question. I ask it on the show every so often. And I'll ask it again. If you sign a non-disclosure, you are signing away your First Amendment rights to free speech. If you can do that, how come you can't sign a contract to be a slave pre-1864 style? Explain.
Well, you're asking for consistency, John, and I don't think...
Explain it. How can you sign away your First Amendment rights in this country?
Because that's
heinous. It doesn't make any sense.
Because First Amendment rights you can sign away, but not the right not to be a slave. It's just a more heinous thing.
It doesn't make any sense at all.
But use your common sense.
You should be able to sign away your personal freedoms, too.
Yeah, well, you could
sign it away.
You could technically sign yourself into indentured servitude, which is like slavery, although...
Oh, really?
I believe if Roger says it, I believe it.
I don't think so.
You don't... All right.
Come on, fight it out, guys!
If I signed myself
up as an indentured servant and then I decided
I load you down with debt that you cannot pay off physically.
Well,
that's
different. That's tricking you.
That's
not the same as signing away your life on something or other.
Yoshi, do you miss this at all?
I'm enjoying the heck out of it just silently off the
side. You know, people do that, sign away things all the time. It's people.
Yeah, I'm talking about rights. Yeah, you sign away your car. You sign away this. You sign away that. I'm talking about rights guaranteed by the Constitution.
You're signing away your First Amendment rights if you sign an NDA. You're signing an NDA to get insider access to information. No. The Patriot Act, that's an act of scumbaggery. That's an act of undermining some of the fundamental foundation of the American government, right? That's bad.
And by the way, Patrick, I'm not talking about that kind of NDA. I'm talking about you go to work for a company and the first thing you do is you sign away your First Amendment rights. You can never talk about what you've done in that company. It's got nothing to do with access.
You mean you're there
I'm
or
sorry.
After you get...
I thought you were talking about being a journalist.
No, wait.
I've never had to sign a corporate NDA.
You never worked for a big company.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Look, well, it's coming up. It's coming up right now. Mark Hurd was fired at HP for, juggling the books because he had a contractor that was kind of cute and he wanted to pay for her and he charged it off against his expenses. Larry Ellison at the time said, "That is the worst, stupidest decision I've ever heard of," and then puts his money where his mouth is, hires Mark Hurd to be one of three presidents of Oracle, and now HP's suing, saying Mark Hurd can't go because he knows stuff. Isn't this the same thing, John? This is Mark Hurd is a slave to HP, can't take a job.
Well, they don't want him,
and he can't go anywhere else.
In California, all those non-compete, all those things have already been thrown out by the Supreme Court of the state, and they don't hold water, and everybody knows it.
Right. They're unenforceable.
But the fact of the matter is, people are still signing away their First Amendment rights elsewhere. In other states that they uphold. I mean, the whole thing is a disaster, and I don't understand why the courts keep putting up with this crap. There should be no such thing as a non-disclosure agreement.
Just clarify what you're referring to when you say a non-disclosure agreement. Are you saying while that person's working there, they can?
You're talking about like stopping whistleblowers, stopping people from talking about inside. Basically, you're saying like when you said NDA, I automatically assume like I got to sign an NDA to see.
No, he's talking about employment contract.
Right. And you're basically talking about in terms of employment, you're not allowed to ever talk about what goes on inside the company.
Right.
But you can be held responsible for that without even signing an NDA. I mean, there's laws on the books called misappropriation, but which is basically the theft of knowledge and using it fraudulently against someone such as an employer.
That's fine. That's different. I don't mind that. In fact, with the NDA that journalists sign, I don't see why anyone signs one. They're crazy. I have been presented with NDAs in my entire career, and all I say is I don't want an NDA. I'll do an embargo, a gentleman's agreement. I won't say anything, but I'm not signing something. And they always agree.
I agree with you on the gentleman's agreement embargo, because you're not going to be able to get those tips anyway unless you do that. So I think that's the way to do it.
Right.
Other than like putting yourself up to be sued for something, what are they going to say? I mean, you don't even see very many of these lawsuits against NDA holders, at least that I know of.
Let's take a different direction on this. John, somebody's fresh out of college. They're 22. They want a job. They accept a job. HR pulls out a 40-pound pile of paperwork. Part of it's like an NDA that says you will never talk about Weasel Corp for the rest of your life, no matter what happens, even if we're killing puppies and small children in the back room instead of building software. So basically, you're telling the kid to walk away from the job or to try to negotiate with the HR team?
I'm saying the kid could, you know, if the kid has to sign that thing to get the job, that's one thing. But if it ever comes down to it, I don't want to see the court saying, hey, this is legit. It's not. It's just a scare tactic. Yeah, sure. You can get some dumb kid to sign anything, and that's fine. And you can buffalo him into thinking he can't talk. That's good, too. That's just kind of fooling a dummy. But the fact of the matter is, if these things are held as legal documents by the courts, then the courts should be ashamed of themselves. That's what I'm complaining about.
If you buy a game now from Electronic Arts, it says you don't own the game. You're licensing the game. You don't.
At what point does that product, moving back to the original discussion.
Roger.
At what point does the product just, do they treat it as a product or they treat it as a service?
I think this is where it gets muddy because it's software, right?
Yeah.
So technically, there's not even necessarily a physical copy of it. It's bits. You're buying an idea.
I mean, you know, one
or renting an idea or the right to interact with an idea.
Well, right? At least in PC gaming, the trend is because
Steam.
Yeah, Steam. You essentially tie the account to the product that they purchased.
This solves it because Steam, you don't have to worry about piracy. You don't have to worry about resale. Nothing. Steam is what everybody likes.
But if you get kicked off of Steam, you lose access to all the content.
Absolutely.
So, it's at some point, is it just become just a plain service?
So the truth is, in the short term, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals has upheld shrink wrap. But in the long term, it doesn't matter because look at where movies are going. Look where music even is going. And of course, gaming is going. Is basically this kind of account based rental, the Zune marketplace. Look at what the new Apple TV is. You don't ever own a TV show. You rent it. You buy a temporary right to stream it.
Yeah, you can. Well, you just can't purchase through the Apple TV.
You can right now. But I think in the long run, they don't want you to own it. And this is pressure from the movie companies, the TV companies. They love the idea of a Roku box or an Apple TV that doesn't store content, just gives you a temporary right because they can revoke that right and they don't have to worry about resale. They don't have to worry about lending. They don't have to worry about libraries. Mm-hmm. That's where we're going, right? Technology is going to support that.
Well, if software goes that way, then they should bring down the price because, if they're charging you $300, for something that...
Yoshi, go ahead.
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say exactly about the pricing because... If you can't sell your software or buy used software, it's going to promote people to pirate it. Because if I'm saying can't buy CS5, but I'll buy a used copy from CS4,
someone
that upgraded, but no, I can't. What's going to make that person be less likely to pirate than not letting them be able to buy a used copy for a cheaper price?
One of the things that's interesting is one of the areas that's had some success lately is startups for around college textbooks.
Yeah.
Actually, the rental model on college textbooks, people are like, it's stupid. But basically, a lot of people in venture capital companies apparently said this is the dumbest idea ever. And the guy who started this company to rent textbooks is making money hand over fist.
Because there's a very brisk resale market in textbooks because they cost $100 plus.
Sure.
If you could charge half as much and not have that resale market, these companies would love that, wouldn't they? And students would love it. Who wouldn't love it?
Right.
So that's a win.
You could even make the rental digital.
That's what a lot of people are saying.
Sure,
the future
Kindle
is
Kindle DX.
And then as soon as the semester ends, it auto deletes from your Kindle.
Yeah,
Do
we have a problem with that, or isn't that okay?
Well, this all comes down to if you are you giving up a little freedom for a little convenience?
That's the crux. I mean, if you want more convenience, you have to give up something in return. It's convenient for a reason, right?
I would submit that the problem is that we're in the middle of a transition from physical goods to virtual goods.
Right.
And that this is where this judgment is a problem, because that AutoCAD software was really perceived by the plaintiff as a physical good that he could resell, perceived by the creator as a virtual good, right, that was, you just really rented the right. And the court upheld the shrink wrap. Maybe this isn't going to be a problem, because in the long run, you're not going to buy a physical good. You're buying bits, or renting bits, I should say. And isn't that better for everybody all along? Because you don't really...
No, it's not better for
everybody.
Why
not, John?
Just look around you. This is a scam. This is just a way to get more money out of your pocket. Mm-hmm.
No, I don't think so, John. I think really, if you think about it, that's what software is.
Seymour Rubenstein's the guy who kind of got this whole ball rolling when he came up with the shrink wrap license agreement idea back in the 80s. When he was doing WordStar, actually before that, there was some merge-purge program.
Yeah.
WordStar.
I had many a talk with this guy, and he says he was hoping he says this is the way to go. And he was talking about how every books and everything can be licensed. You wouldn't own anything ever, and it would just mean more money for these guys, because there wouldn't be a secondary market. There wouldn't be a gray market, which people love to hate if they want to screw the public. This is all about screwing the public. Don't let me be able to hand a book to you that I just read. Screw it. You have to buy a new copy. That whole model sucks as far as I'm concerned.
That's because you're an old fart. Really, it's just ideas. It's just bits. You don't really want to hold on to it, John. Really, do you? I mean, after you've read it.
I want to give you a copy. I want to give it to you, Leo.
Well, that's stealing.
How is that stealing? It's not stealing with books.
It wouldn't be if it were a car.
No. If the book had a EULA printed inside of it,
it would be stealing.
It would be considered stealing under this law.
So that's what I'm saying.
And you think that's good?
No, I don't think that's good. There's a reason I buy CDs. There's a reason I buy Blu-rays. A, I want a physical copy of the media. And B, I want the best possible quality of the data. And you know what? A lot of the online distribution of media sucks. A lot of the 720p.
Physical media is going to be a boutique industry for people like you who care about the content, the quality of the content, and want to, for some crazy reason, think that it's good to own a movie. The rest of us will just buy the right to view it for 2 days.
I think that what you'll eventually see is you'll see a parallel market where creators and the end users will directly interface instead of working through a publisher, a middleman company that does... I mean, if you think about it, if you go to a band and they say, hey, you know what? We just made these CDs in our garage. We'll sell it to you for like $10. You get all our music and stuff. Instead of going through, you know, a reprise record.
Why is it okay in textbooks but not okay in, you know, Ernest Hemingway? Is it because textbooks have less? Well, I mean, we just endorsed the notion that you don't own a textbook and there's no resale right. As being good for everybody.
No, less. I said it was a successful business model.
Oh, you don't like the idea.
I remember textbooks weren't $100 when I was in college. I was in college forever ago.
Right.
I was also a lit major, so half the stuff I was buying was paperback
novels,
books.
Yeah.
It was novels, right? I know people who have had to, you know, in the last couple, 3 years, we've had to lay out like $600-$700 up front a semester for their books for like 3 or 4 classes, right?
My textbooks were like $90.
And you don't really want a textbook after you've completed the class. It loses its value immediately, whereas Ernest Hemingway might have value down the road.
Yeah, I mean, there's not a lot of people going like, boy, I'm going to want this accounting 101 book forever so I can look back at those first days of double entry, right?
So textbooks, it kind of makes sense.
You pay half price up front. You give them the book back at the end of the semester. They rent it again.
Right.
Okay, so you're not allowed to run the highlighter in the edges, you know?
Well, you can if you just have a Kindle that allows you to do, you know, that.
But in this case, they're actually renting physical copies of
books. Yeah. But that's why I guess ultimately digital is the
future. This is the idealism, this idea, because many of the textbooks get updated yearly just to prevent this sort of thing. For a long time, the used textbook market was very vibrant in most colleges.
Oh, it still is.
University of California. No, you go to University of California where those used textbook places are. They're all gone because now the professors are in bed with these publishers and they sign new books. They have to be the newest version because there's something changed on page 50.
Correct.
Thing is part of the giant scam. We're just having our money stolen from us.
Again with a scam.
It's a scam.
See,
it's just a ripoff.
That,
the public needs to stand up to this crap.
If you're going to have books that cost as much as they do, It would be in my best interest. I think for the students' best interest is not to saddle them with all that initial expense right off the bat when they're getting started in school and just be able to provide that digitally in such a way where, you know, it, make it as affordable as possible or to the point where it shouldn't even be a cost to the student. It's like if they sign up for a course, here's the digital download. Just go to town with it and use it as you see fit.
There you go. Software, socialism.
For kind of, but for software, though, we've been dealing with this, at least on the gaming side of things, for PCs for a long time now. You could not open, as soon as you took the shrink wrap off the outside of the box, you effectively owned it. You couldn't return it for almost no reason short of physical defect or, fortunately, sometimes you actually get a piece of software so bad that you had to actually, you could declare it a defective piece of software and then return it. But even today, it's still the same way.
What gets me about that, I don't even, you know, that's that model, that train also has left the station. We're stuck with this model. But what gets me is the fact that they can put in those EULAs liability considerations. So in other words, if you're using this software in a hospital and somebody dies because the software is crap or it doesn't work as advertised, it doesn't do what it's supposed to do, and people actually die from the software, you can't do anything about it. That's ridiculous.
I agree. Some kind of EULA reform should be there. So, there should be like a basic.
But a lot of EULAs fall apart in court. I mean, they write a lot of stuff in the EULAs that we all know is bogus. Right or wrong.
And software,
huh?
Actually, for a while there, that would actually check your EULA for you.
That's what we need.
To see if there's any suspect language in it. And honestly, as funny as those pieces of software are, it'd be better if most of us probably used them because I don't read EULAs. I'll be perfectly honest with you. I need whatever I just purchased installed that moment, and I'm just going to click the buttons until the magic happens. So
I need to take a break. Yoshi, are you okay in the car there still?
Oh, yeah.
I miss you, Yoshi. Do you ever come up to Northern California?
A few times a year.
Come up and say hi sometime, will you?
Yeah.
Love to see you. We are having fun. This is a TWiT reunion.
I guess parents in the cottage.
And I'd love to make an appearance, have you make an appearance at the cottage. This is a TWiT reunion of the voices that you might have heard if you listened to TWiT way back in 2005. Roger Chang is here. He's now, you guys all now work together, which is kind of cool too. Roger Chang works at TechZilla. Of course, TechZilla's host, this guy here, Mr. Patrick Norton. Also on the phone with us, Robert Heron, who does HD Nation with Patrick Norton. John C. Dvorak, who works with nobody.
Actually, but we appear on the show every night, once in a while.
You can see why.
All I do is complain.
Everybody loves John C. Dvorak. He's the father of us all.
Oh, God.
And David Prager, who's at Revision 3. In fact, really kind of for a long time, you were Revision 3, David. Let's face it.
It was, I was the only full-time employee for a while.
We were watching the old system where you and Kevin came up here, and I was still up in the little tiny room just by myself. And I imagine you held the camera on that thing. I mean, you held the camera on that first Ignition we were watching, I'm sure.
Oh, wow. We did like, what was it? How to Podcast or something?
Yeah, you remember that?
And we said that basically like there's the low-end solution and then there's the fancy high-end solution, which was you had, different auxiliary inputs. And it was like, oh, my God.
Oh,
and you're using Audigy to edit.
How does he do it? Yeah. We've gone a little bit beyond that at this point, I have to say. And we're still not done. It's kind of fun. Seeing what toys we can buy. I have to admit, I'm already trying to figure out, I'm going to be in France in December for Le Web, and I'm trying to figure out how I can broadcast Le Web. Isn't that funny?
Are you going to that as a paid speaker?
No, you know what I found out? We've worked this out since, but I sent a note to Loic, who throws this. He's the guy at Seismic, and I said, okay, I'm ready to go. Do I buy the ticket and get reimbursed? Do you buy it? And he says, no, we'll give you a small stipend. I said, well, wait a minute. That's not even going to cover the ticket. I can't go. I'm not going to pay to speak. So we worked it out. But no, I am not a paid speaker there.
You got him to fly a business class, huh?
You heard about that. How'd you hear about that?
I just made that up because I figured that was the case.
Well, I am
good
not going
one,
to
Prager. That's how you do it.
Look at it. He's a journalist. I now have to NDA you. No, I just, it was like, I'm not flying 10 hours in a little tiny seat. Because I'm a big guy.
I agree with you. I mean, I think it's worth it for them to have you at their conference.
So we're gonna broadcast live there, and now we use this live view thing, you know, that uses 3G. It doesn't work in Europe because it's different frequencies. But I think they told me that they'll have drop shift to Paris, a live view for Paris. So we'll stream live, and Kevin's gonna be there speaking. So I'm gonna get Kevin and a bunch of other people. We'll do it all in French. It'll be so much fun. Mike Arrington's gonna be there, but I don't know if he'll consent to be on camera with me anymore. I think I finally cheesed him off beyond repair. This episode brought to you by our friends at Audible.com. You know Audible. That's the great place where you get audiobooks to listen to. Boy, when I was doing the screensavers and I had that two-hour commute every day to and from Petaluma to San Francisco, Audible just saved my life. I don't think I could have survived without those great books, and I'm still listening to Audible books. The other day I was looking. They have a new Audible app for iPhone and Android, and I was looking at – it's cool because the app gives you all the books you've ever that you own, that you've ever listened to. They do it kind of – this is a nice thing. They do have copy protection. You can't sell or rent or anything, but you at least have access to that book in the library forever. So you can always go back and re-listen to a book. So I think this is kind of a nice compromise. I admit I'm not crazy about DRM. The publishers don't give them an option. I saw that you have Patrick Norton, the new William Gibson novel, there in your hot little hands. Zero history.
It's delightful.
You could read it, like Patrick's doing, in the dead tree fashion. Or...
And I'll own this dead tree. Forever.
Well, so will I. So will I. Can listen anytime I want. You could listen to Robertson Dean, who's one of their best narrators. In fact, let me play a little bit of Zero History. This is the brand new, just came out 3 days ago, Stephen Gibson novel.
Cabinet's members in the performing arts were somewhat less than stellar, and she assumed that that suited Inchmale just about as well as it suited her.
Now what's this about, Patrick? What's the book about?
Oh, boy. I'm just going to read the jacket flap.
Did you just start?
Well, basically.
Yeah, you're just big beginning right there.
Yeah. It's big. You know,
is it sci-fi?
It's the stuff he's been doing lately. Hubertus Big End is back. Hollis Henry worked for the global marketing magnate Hubertus Big End, who was the founder of
Blue Ant. Yeah.
He's a great character or archetype. But she's broke, and Big End never feels it's beneath him to use whatever power comes his way. So you start out in this really insane hotel in London with a cab, and then mayhem is beginning to ensue.
It's now on Audible. You can read it in paper. Sure you can, but Audible makes it so fun because they read it to you. You listen, you enjoy. It's like a movie in your mind. I mean, I'm not kidding. It plays out on my skull. And oftentimes I'll have listened to this book and I could swear I saw it. And really it was the book in your head. There's something about, there really is something different about listening versus reading and the way your brain processes it. And I happen to really like it. Many people don't. That's why we offer a free book, actually two free books, so you can get a sense of whether Audible's right for you. If you go to audible.com/twit2, you'll sign up for the Platinum account. That's two books a month. That's what I have. And frankly, sometimes that's not even enough, but it's a good start. And your first two books are free. Your first month's free. You can cancel it anytime, so you don't have to pay anything. You get to keep those books forever. Plays on every device, Android now, as well as all the Apple devices, as well as the Kindle, many GPS devices. There's a whole device list, hundreds of devices, or just on your computer. It's a great way to read. Read in those times when you cannot hold a book, like the gym, like the commute, housework, walking the dog. I listen every chance I get, and I just love it. Audible.com/twit2. Try it free today, and this is our book of the week. Zero History, brand new from William Gibson. I'm so glad you brought that in, Patrick, because that inspired me, and I'm going to add this to my list.
Apparently, he was doing a signing in Berkeley yesterday.
He was in town, and he didn't call me? I hate it when that happens.
You know how these book tours are.
Damn that William. I've interviewed him. I have interviewed him.
People.
Yeah, he's great.
He's
really
on Twitter,
cool.
Too.
He's on Twitter now, and he has a strange handle. What is it?
Great Dismal.
What is it? Great Dismal?
Yes.
Awesome. Audible.com/twit. Too,
believe it or not, I actually listen to audiobooks while running.
Yes.
I've been training for this marathon that I'm doing, and so increasingly these runs last for well over an hour, and I need to like engage myself while doing it. And then you'll find yourself able to run further because you're so engaged in the story that you want to keep running to keep listening to it.
Sure.
Just kind of funny.
No, it's great. Sometimes I'll sit in the driveway with the motor running because I don't want to stop yet.
You can just turn it to the accessory and just turn off.
Yeah, I do that. They're saying, John, come back, John. Come back, John.
What, the chat room?
Yeah. They love you, John.
They goad me.
You're beloved. By the way, William Gibson does tweet a lot. I'm kind of thrilled that he tweets so much.
Yeah.
You know what? The content is good. What is it again? Twitter.com/greatdismal. What is that from? Great Dismal.
I
I've yet to figure
it out. Something in, it sounds like something in the Quicksilver saga, maybe. Or his most recent tweet.
There's a great dismal swan.
Marmont then and now. Promiscuous but very good-hearted bohemian aunt. Rediscovered working for high-end escort service. No idea what that means.
I think he was saying at the Chateau Marmont for the
Oh, then and now. Oh, so the Chateau Marmont before was a promiscuous but very good-hearted bohemian aunt. Now, she's working for high-end escorts. I still don't know what that means.
He's basically saying, like, it's just gotten even weirder.
Weirder and weirder.
Yeah.
Looking fundamentally untrustworthy. I think he just likes words. Liminally velour robe.
It's almost velour poetry. Robe is a type of human being. Is kind of a non-nice description of a human being.
Really?
Used in Zero History.
See, I need Patrick to gloss his tweets. He does wear those shoes, though. The shoes that are on his Twitter. Those are hit. That's his feet. I've seen those shoes.
Yeah, well, sneakers, he actually does kids. A bunch of stuff. Buzz Rixons, who was the maker of these sort of mythical Japanese remakes of classic American pieces of clothing, military clothing. It's actually a real company.
Oh, neat.
And they make ridiculous, like, historical remakes of classic pieces of mostly military.
When we were at Maker Faire in Detroit, mm-hmm. Ford brought us out there, and Utila Kilts was there.
Nice.
And I said, I said, Patrick Norton says hi. They said, who? But the thought was there.
Nobody there knows me anymore.
Nobody you know is there anymore. But the thought was there. There was also a woman there selling gag balls. I don't know if that's related.
What?
I woke those, John.
Suddenly John wakes up.
Make jokes about.
I woke John up.
Quick, go to 4chan, John.
What?
Search.
What?
Gags, balls.
Never mind.
Unleash the gimp.
Forget I said anything.
Two ducks walked into a bar.
Stop it. Lady, Indians ride bareback. Moving right along. See, that's one way to
a
be
classic.
A classic.
I've been joking a really long time.
You like that? Google says 80,000 apps are in the Android marketplace. They said there were some interesting numbers from the Google search event where they announced Google Instant. They said this was, I thought, interesting. 1 billion people every week use Google services. I think this is kind of a response to the Facebook half billion, right? Half billion a month, that's nothing. We got a billion a week.
Wow.
They also said, I thought this was kind of surprising, that 20% of all searches, 1 in 5, they had never seen before. Somebody's
what?
They had never seen before. And that's important for Google because they cache a lot of searches. So those are searches that they have no cache. There's no record of. They have to start all over and go through their index with.
Let me search for something that I haven't searched for before.
How about liminally velour robe?
Liminally.
Can you even spell it? I don't know what you'd get. But there's an example. I mean, you could say things that you...
Well, you get William Gibson and velour bathrobe at Amazon.
I get robes and accessories at tournamentconcepts.com.
Oh, Victoria's Secrets?
Luxury all right. Stop it.
I think Google Instant, though, is going to make people better searchers who probably weren't probably decent searchers to begin with, just for the fact that by maybe changing keywords as you're typing them in and getting a feel for, you know, how to create a good search to begin with, I think just having that instant feedback makes a big difference.
I think that's Google's idea, actually, is
yeah.
To kind of lead you down the path of proper search as opposed to the stupid stuff you've been typing in.
And you to know, distract I, the crap out of you.
Well, that's not my... Yeah,
you
think
might
that's
be looking for one
I think,
thing,
exactly,
and you know
Prager's
exactly...
Right.
That was awesome. Huh? You like completely canceled each other out.
It was like a wave...
Prager's right. Prager, tell him what you think.
I think that, like, you know exactly what you want to find because you're an experienced computer user, an experienced syntax user of Google, syntax. And you start typing something and it auto searches for other stuff and distracts you by enticing you to read other things that you don't want to read. But since we all have ADD, it's going to take us away
and this
from
is,
what we want to do and make us less productive.
Is this good for Google? Why?
They get to sell more ads.
True. I just close my eyes while I'm typing in my search stuff now, but...
I'm a huge fan of Chrome, though. I like having a single bar at the top. I don't understand
why
you have
that. That's my question, is why, who even uses Google.com anymore? Does anybody?
When I'm not using Chrome, I do.
If you're using Firefox, they have that little box. If you're using Internet Explorer, you have that little box. If you're using Safari, you have that little box.
It's
if you're
habit.
Using Chrome, you just use the URL window.
It's habit.
So you go to google.com?
Not all the time, but I just do it automatically. It's just habitual. I've done it for so long that I automatically do it. Yeah, I'll even do it in Chrome. It's retarded, but...
uh-huh. Yoshi, what do you use? You're a professional...
I use Chrome, but I used a little bar for my searches.
Yeah.
I set Google for my homepage for some reason.
Oh, so it's your homepage. Okay, that's interesting.
But I don't use it for the searches. I go up and click on the bar.
Well, that's one of the things I really like about Chrome is that you don't make a distinction. Was it Firefox that invented this? They called it the anywhere, everywhere bar or something like that, the magical... So how many, chat room, let me ask the chat room, how many of you in the chat room use the Google front page? Let me just see, because this is, it's been my contention that I never use the awesome bar, thank you, that I never use the front page, but I'm surprisingly large number of people, well, now I can't make head or tails of what I'm seeing.
I'm seeing a lot of.
I don't know what that, yeah, nobody, yes, you want to,
no, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no,
yes, 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 no, no, no,
and Bing, what about Bing?
What about Bing? There's always that one guy.
Bing.
I use Bing.
Bing's pretty.
Bing is pretty, but you can do the same thing with Google, you know, if you add a background image.
This is true.
It can look just like Bing. Let me see, which is pretty bizarre. Like editor's picks. Don't use a public gallery. Editor's pick. Here, there you go. Now watch. Now my Google looks just like Bing.
Does it change every day, though?
No. Bing does. Oh. So why did Google do instant search? What's the idea here? What do they gain from this? Would somebody explain to me? Anybody got any idea? What's the point?
They're trying to scam you. Sorry.
Well, are you channeling John?
Yes.
I think part of it's also just to give the illusion that something's happening, that they're new.
That's what I think. I think this is the
progress is being made.
This is Leo's 25% rule, that if the stock market doesn't think you're growing by 25%, they punish you in the price. So you have to do stupid things nobody wants to pretend, and you buy companies that you're never going to use, like Dodgeball. You do stuff, you create buzz, you create, you know, products nobody ever wants. All because you're trying to keep the stock price artificially inflated. That's my.
Oh, they screwed up with Dodgeball. They could have made it into something good.
But that's the point is they don't need. It's like they could have, but they can't. They don't. What's the problem here, Google?
Well, don't they still have their employees, or don't they ask them to use 20% of their time to think about entrepreneurial ideas?
Yeah. Some of that stuff ends up.
Yeah, right.
Some of its stuff ends up being, you know, good, but most of it I don't think, you know. I don't know. That's a good question. But this is my fundamental question is, isn't Silicon Valley now being driven to create just for the sake of creation?
Yes.
Shouldn't Google just sit back and say we got a great search engine?
I mean, look, you know, who needs Foursquare?
I don't use it.
But Leo, you use it? Prager, Foursquare?
Oh, man, I cannot handle, like, they've got Facebook Places, Foursquare, Gowalla, and it's just getting to be, like, too much. I actually like being able to check into places, but now there's just so many of them, and ever since Facebook's trying to take people on with it, and then they're trying to get you to check other people into places, and it's
But doesn't
just,
it feel like a chore now?
Yes. Yeah.
It's like, why?
It's this compulsion circle again.
Well, part of it, though, is instant search is kind of a counter to Bing's... type ahead stuff for keywords.
Right.
So in that sense, it's them being competitive within the market space. Checkbox features.
This is what happened to me the other day. I unlocked the overshare badge on Foursquare. Do you know how you get
the mayor of my mom's
What
bedroom.
Does that even mean?
Do you know how you get the overshare badge on Foursquare? You share like 20 times in 10 check-ins in 12 hours.
Mr. TMI.
TMI. That was quite embarrassing. Almost as embarrassing as the school night badge.
I'm the mayor of the bathroom. Do you know? I'm the mayor of the lunchroom. I'm the mayor of my cubicle.
Yes,
I'm the mayor of Roger's cubicle.
Exactly.
Your cubicle's right across from mine, so technically it's almost.
This is the other embarrassing badge I just recently earned. Checking in after 3 a.m. on a school night.
Yeah, baby.
Middle of the night check-ins, you know, folks.
You know, in many ways, this is very similar to the Xbox Live achievements. where you get, you know, you get achievements for complete. And it's not even anything significant in the game. It's like, hey, you passed five or whatever. And I think it's one of those things where people like to see some sort of recognition of their efforts, no matter how dubious it might be.
It shows you how pathetic my little life is.
Well, you and I'm sure tens of millions of others around the world.
Prager, you still check in?
I do.
And you were the guy that, you were getting burgled and you put it on Twitter?
I used Twitter because I thought it was strange that a random person walked through my studio apartment at the
time. That's my first inclination.
Wait, wasn't he sleep? Didn't you find him sleeping on your bed?
No. See, that I started a Ustream, and when I started the Ustream, after I was tweeting about it, I wasn't caching it. So someone was screen recording because the Ustream wasn't set to cache it, and so that picked up when it was a guy who I yanked out of my bathroom, and he fell over on the bed on the way out. So everyone thought that I found a Goldilocks sleeping in my bed or something.
He was not a Goldilocks.
I saw him. Did you ever get any more on that story? Was that just it? You never heard from him again?
As far as who the person was, I have no idea. I think for probably every week for almost a year, I would get an inquiry from some random press outlet. And I think the most interesting one that it made it to was I was in the in-flight magazine for Air India. And I guess Air India is a big enough airline that people that I knew happened to have been flying Air India during that month. And they said, oh, my God, you're in the print section of Air India.
Oh, boy. Wow. Wow. For that.
Yeah.
Wow. So here's Erlesque with a parody, Fun with Google Instant. This is with Billy Joel's. We didn't start the fire, of course. They type presents, fun with presents, fun with Dick and Jane, Google Instant. Harry Truman, Doris Day, Red China, Johnny Ray, South Pacific, Walter Winchell, Joe DiMaggio. They're typing in all of the terms from We Didn't Start the Fire. It's pretty good. Cheesecake, cheese, synthesizer, cheesy synthesizer. You really have to see this. How to start a fire.
I do see two things in that video,
demonstration
though.
It is. And look how fast it is. It's amazing.
See, that's one thing. It shows off performance for Google in one of their products. Or at least I still believe with the whole thing of it making people better searchers in the long run in terms of just giving them ideas about, you know what? You didn't think about maybe searching for these other two keyword terms. Here they are listed right below it for you to just
consider. I think it makes people lazier searchers because don't think for themselves anymore.
They should work harder. Well, Google at the same time announced something called Google Scribe, which makes makes lazier writers. Isn't it true, John, you're a writer, that you really don't want to take the first phrase that leaps to mind?
Because it depends.
Depends on how much of a hurry you're in.
I'm not backing you up at all today, Leo. It's unbelievable.
No, well, I think, John, perhaps when you had to write a column a day, you might have been glad to take the obvious cliche. But
you don't pay any attention to that at all. You just put everything down, and then you kill that stuff at the beginning, which is usually garbage, and you find your real lead down further.
So Google Scribe, if you look closely.
It took me years to realize that. Thank you, John.
Yeah, you spit it out and then fix it. Yeah, no, that's the way to write. So this is Google Scribe. It'll work. You can actually put a bookmarklet in your browser and any text field, it'll work. It uses the same technology as Google Instant. It suggests the next phrase as you start typing. So I typed, we didn't star, and then look, number three, start the fire. I just press three, and it finishes my sentence. The problem is, of course, you're going to get cliches because the suggestions are what people type the most, right? So give me a phrase. How about let this...
One in the hand.
Is...
4 score and 7.
Oh, yeah, let's try 4. Let's see what would have done with the Gettysburg Address. 4 score and... Oh,
yeah. You got it. It's already got it.
Yeah, it's got it. Years... Oh, it knows. Ago, 3.
Go, you're a criminal. You start... Just make a mess out of it. See what you can come up with.
You're a criminal.
You would just click a
rock star. Okay.
4 score and 7 years ago, you're a rock star.
And what? Now what? And okay, I'll take that.
Put the word dog.
The dog
was
doggy ribbed.
Ribbed.
my
It doesn't deal well with velour, expletives, I'll tell you that much.
This is the song lyric generator. I figured it out.
Velour seat upholstery with a gigantic... Oh, it doesn't like... Inflatable. Oh, I misspelled it.
I think this would be better if it was cranking out poetry.
Whirlpool.
Oh, I was thinking of something else.
The lady said...
So basically you're saying you've turned the entire internet and the largest and most powerful group of servers in the planet into a giant Mad Lib substitute?
Yes. Anyway, that's Google Scribe. Thank you, Google, for a very wonderful, useful technology, which, again, no one will ever use again.
So wait a minute. If I took a bunch of chimps and I put them at a keyboard, will they eventually just come across like...
Just to,
Google will buy
it. Now it's true. Now the chimps can write everything.
They can. They got all the cliches in the world. Yoshi,
remember old phrase, you know, if you had an infinite number of monkeys, they would write all the world's great books.
At an infinite number of typewriters writing for an infinite length of time.
Yes.
Yeah.
You got to have all three.
Well,
it's that infinite length of time, that infinite.
I figured that they'd get the job done before infinity ended.
Well, you might get some of Shakespeare, but would you get all of Shakespeare? No. Yoshi, are you okay there?
Yeah.
Didn't pass out?
No, didn't pass out.
Okay. Let's move along. Have we done the Google thing? I think we've done everything. We talked about instant search. Is there anything else to say about it? Are we excited about it? Is this a wonderful change? We're still waiting for Google Music and Google TV to come out. Is Google TV, now that Apple kind of punted on Apple TV, is Google TV going to be great, going to suck? Robert, this is your bailiwick. You and Patrick do HD Nation.
Yeah.
Are you going to run out and
I have high hopes for.
Tell me about it. Why? Uh-oh, we lost your audio. Hello? Robert, there. You're sitting on a mute button. Robert, look at that. He's just talking. He's like the Google Scribe of show hosts. Hey, Robert. Robert.
He's giving us information. We can't hear it.
He's talking. Robert.
He's probably like spitting
Robert,
out
we don't hear you.
Hey, can someone type in the Skype and saying that?
He's just talking. It's good. You know, whatever he's saying, I'm sure it's...
No. What we do is you leave it up. And then we talk underneath him.
Okay, so let's say,
So then what I think is that Google Scribe merged with Google TV is going to give us a whole new paradigm
you
for overall.
You killed my sister. Prepare to die.
My name is...
something's
up. He figured it out.
Uh-oh.
He figured it out.
Oh, no.
My name is Inigo Montoya.
We have a problem.
Was he the guy who liked The Princess Bride?
No, that was me.
I was.
Okay.
Was. Robert, can you hear us?
Savages.
Oh!
Oh,
he got mad.
He got mad and he hung up.
For all the people just listening,
don't make fun because I like Princess Bride. Why?
Yeah, what did that sound like, Yoshi? Because you couldn't see anything.
What did it sound like, me laughing?
It just sounded weird, right? Just weirdness. Just strange stuff. Let's see. Google's founder, Sergey Brin, said, "We want to be the third half of your brain."
No. There's no such thing as a third of a half.
Really?
There's such thing as a third of a half. There's no such thing as a third half.
Yeah, a third half. You are correct.
We want to be the third half of your brain. We don't want to be a third of the half of your brain. We want to be the third half of your brain.
So instead of being a sixth.
And then Eric Schmidt says, we want to know what you're searching for before you search for it. Does this worry anybody?
Why don't they just live my life for me then?
I think this is the whole idea of Google.
They will.
There we go.
Shortly.
Well, that's their version of unified string theory, apparently.
Robert,
do we have audio?
Can you hear anything? Earth to Heron. He's pressed the mute button. You know that's what's going on. He's just puzzled by the whole
just
thing.
Can we type?
I didn't change any of my settings.
There, you're good. You're good. Don't change it. You probably sat on the mute button.
Did one of the dogs eat something on your keyboard?
How does everything go from working just perfectly to just not working at all?
So, let's go back to...
Okay, my mic is on, that's for sure.
Yeah, and can you hear us? You can't hear us.
Can I read something real quick?
Yeah, go ahead, John.
Give me a second here.
I just want you to tell me what I'm reading. When a young boy falls ill, his grandfather pops around to visit him. To cheer his grandson up, grandpa has bought a storybook. The Princess Bride, a tale of the love between the beautiful Buttercup and the besotted Wesley, a love cruelly interrupted by Wesley's tragic apparent death at sea when seeking his fortune.
Okay, first of all, the book is not the movie. Second of all, dude,
let it go.
I think that's like the IMDb.
We all know the synopsis.
You
didn't cry when Old Yeller died.
You know what's funny is John Dvorak could be given a free 1 week vacation trip to Disney World and he'd still crap on it.
Episode one is your favorite Star Wars movie.
Say it, John. The only thing you could pass are stones.
I'm shaken to the bone.
The only thing you can... Where did you get that?
I don't know.
Where did you get that?
He stole it from someone.
That's bizarre.
By the way, can you do Cranky Geeks on Wednesday?
Yeah. Finally, it happens.
Can I, Patrick?
Absolutely.
Patrick says it's okay.
Yeah, we're doing two shows. We have to...
Two?
No, I don't want you to do two shows. I want you to do one.
All right, we're going to take a break, and maybe Robert will figure it out. Robert, are you there? Can you hear me? No, he hung up again. Yoshi, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
Okay, checking. Everybody go get coffee. You can have a break now. This is it. We got some great coffee. Get some coffee for Mr. Norton there. We have the Aerobi AeroPress. It's from the same people who make the Frisbee. It's a press thing that it's a plunger.
Is it like a French press?
No, because it has a filter, and it's plunging under high pressure. It's like something Yoshi would have made, but it makes great coffee. I mean, it's incredible coffee.
How's it not a cappuccino machine?
Because it's not a bit. John, what is this shot? John's putting up a piece of paper. There he is. Okay.
He just wanted to give you a good white balance.
Yeah. I was going on vacation.
You
I was going to take
put
a break.
His face in
I
the
just
camera.
Feel like when John does that, I feel like he's taking off his clothes and dancing around naked, and he just... He just doesn't
you
want us
wish,
to see it.
You wish, Leo. You wish.
I would love to see that. So here it is. This is the Aerobi AeroPress.
It looks like AeroPress. The top of a Cuisinart.
So
does this part
it does.
Get edited out of the show?
Never. No,
in?
We've decided no longer to edit the show.
Let's see it again.
Okay, so here it is. So it's three parts. It's very simple. The only thing negative, it's plastic. Although, if you go to, like, the coffee forums.
Here I am, the bouncing ball.
There's people who make like stainless steel ones of these with compressors and stuff. So it's very simple. There's a white paper filter that goes in there, seals up that up. You fill this up with actually substantial.
You follow me, camera guy?
It's from Germany, so you know it's great, John. And you fill this up with a lot of coffee, actually 4 tablespoons of coffee. And then you fill it up with water at 175 degrees, not boiling, because that
so
makes the coffee
to,
bitter.
Is it plexiglass or is it just...
No, it's plastic. It should be plexi.
Well, I'm just wondering, how are you going to pour 104 degrees worth of...
175 degrees of water.
Without burning yourself.
No, it's got a funnel. We just actually put it under the thing. And then here. This is how. You got me, camera guy? You following me? Okay. So you pour it in there.
That
okay.
It's like a float bowl.
You let it sit. It's got a little stirrer. It stirs it up 10 seconds, and then you plunge. Now, this is a pretty good seal, so you're getting a lot of PSIs in there. And you plunge through
the
coffee.
It just sounds like you're going to burn yourself accidentally.
This is the craziest thing I've ever
seen.
It
makes the best cup of coffee you've ever had. I'm not kidding.
Pshaw?
Come on over and I'll make you a cup of coffee. Watch, Patrick. Here, make... Hey, Patrick's a coffee connoisseur. Would you make him a cup of the best coffee he's ever had? He drinks it black, though.
Actually, you know, when it's assembled like that, it looks like a specimen collector.
I'd like to talk about squarespace.com if you don't mind. Go ahead. You may continue to take a break, folks, because this is the time where we do ads. And as everyone knows, nobody listens to the ads.
That's not true.
No, it's not true. In fact, one of the reasons people advertise on this show is because we do the ads in such an engaging fashion that nobody skips through them, that people love them, because they're afraid they might miss a bon mot, a something from Roger that just makes you howl with laughter. So, Roger, if you get a chance, just, you know, anything.
Howl.
Yeah, something about it. The last thing he passed was a stone or something would be great.
No, I just say he only thing he could pass is a stone.
Right now.
Wow.
Squarespace.com, the secret behind exceptional websites. I know Kevin's using it. Sarah's using it. We use it for our behind-the-scenes blog, inside.twit.tv. It is a really... Now, the thing I like about this is hosting plus very sophisticated software that makes it easy to make a site that is unique, that is beautiful. All you have to do is go to the examples page to get an idea of the variety of incredible sites. All of these are Squarespace sites. None of them look alike. That looks like a very simple, basic site. And go back here. Don Imus' site looks like a country and western star. This is all using the amazing templates. But then the point-and-click customization. Here's Jeff Cannata's site, another Revision 3 fella. He does a really nice job on here. The Totally Rad Show. Squarespace.com. It's the secret to amazing websites. Not only are they easy to create a great design, it's very easy to post. You don't have to think about it now. You can use the great iPhone app or do it from the web. Or they've got importing from virtually all the web blog sites, so you can import your data so you don't start from scratch. And, by the way, export. You're never trapped. Fantastic stats, links to all the social networks, galleries, form building. Really fantastic. But best thing, and you don't have to take my word for it, try it free for 14 days. Just go to squarespace.com/twit. If you decide to buy, and the site's start at $8 a month, that's really, for most people, that's all you need. You'll get 10% off for the life of the site when you use the offer code TWIT. It's the secret behind exceptional sites. I love it, and I know you will too. Squarespace.com. Yoshi, do you have a website?
I have not been upkeeping my website. It still exists, and for some strange reason, people still go there, but I have not.
You had a forum for a while that was great. What is your site?
It's yoshi.us/forums, but I mean, I literally have not been upkeeping it, but it's still...
You and Patrick... And Roger, do you have a site?
No.
See, you guys.
I have a site launching shortly.
Is this the TypePad site, or are you going to do a Squarespace site? Do a Squarespace site. Would you?
We have a couple Squarespace sites over here.
Do you?
Yeah, the noagendashow.com is a Squarespace site.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yep.
Eileen tells me she does Bike Club. Our new producer, by the way, we want to welcome Eileen Rivera.
Woohoo!
Yay! We stole her. Jim Latterback called me up and said, "You poached our best employee."
I think well,
that's
like,
telling
like
those guys.
Myself
she doesn't watch the princess.
You are a valuable asset, but you're not the most cheerful asset.
And that was not in the
Roger. You want to come to work for me, Roger? You know where to. No, I'm not. I didn't poach anybody. But Tom Merritt came here, and Eileen happens to know him, and so, you know, it just happened that way.
And they also are like 20 like miles babies. From you, or less than that, right?
Yeah, they moved to Marin because Tom's working here, and they decided that it'd be easier for. Anyway, we're so happy to have Eileen. She does a podcast called Bike Club. Mm-hmm. You know about Bike Club, right?
It involves vampires.
Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to know who came up with the name for that podcast.
Was it you, Roger Chang?
Yes, it was.
He's Changry.
He is very mad.
He is Changry.
He's steamed.
And by the way, Robert's looking to be called back.
I'm back.
You are back.
I called him and then I don't know. Did you figure it out, Robert? What was going on?
I have no idea. Suddenly all audio stopped on my end and I never did. It indicated in Skype that my connection was lagging for some reason, but now I'm back up to full green bars.
I just like to make a point. Please don't watch the show because we kind of mocked you.
It's okay. Was I nerding out?
It was awesome. We all wanted to hear what you were saying. You had really enthusiastic stream of thought going.
I was on it.
And we were like, okay.
Well, remember what you said. I'm going to ask you in a second about Google TV again. Is this the same Bike Club, the resource for the restaurant and bar culture?
No. It's Bike Club SF, I believe. Wait, no, it's the Bike Club Show.
BikeClubShow.com, is it? Okay. This is it. Anyway, she was telling me that Baby Jessica's blog from True Blood is a Squarespace blog, which kind of impressed me. I mean, that's probably got a lot of traffic. Which vampires do you like best, the Twilight vampires? She's laughing like a crazed. True Blood, you better believe it, baby.
Sookie.
Sookie. Get in here, Sookie. Get in my belly. So, Robert, now that we've got you back.
Yes.
What do you think? You said all we heard was you were excited about Google TV.
I was. I was simply hoping that it becomes the first at least toehold for consumers to get a la carte choicing for premium content.
Yes, thank you.
The whole bit with, I mean, YouTube videos are great. The population creating content that others can see easily is wonderful. But for the content that we look at on TV that we all, you know, really want and generally have to pay for through either a cable or satellite subscription, somebody's got to start delivering this stuff online somehow. And I could even care less about quality at this point.
That's the interesting thing, isn't
it? Yeah,
we figured that out.
It'll be 720p, but...
Quality!
720p is fine.
Yeah.
720p is fine. So how about Apple TV? Were you disappointed that they didn't really go a la carte? I mean, it is a la carte, but they could have put apps in there. They really could have done something a little more exciting.
Well, here's the thing. As somebody who owns an iPad... the iPad, the iPhone apps look pretty mediocre on the iPad by just by doubling.
Well, what about so like the Hulu? No, no, you'd have to use iPad apps. You're right. Or Apple TV apps.
Taking those applications and trying to dump them onto the Apple TV would look even uglier.
Right.
And two, there's interface issues trying to use the Apple TV in its current incarnation. Three.
No, but the new Apple TV is iOS, and it's got an A4. It is basically an iPad.
I understand that, but you know, in which case, if you want to use the Apple iOS interface with the Apple TV,
right.
You need to own an iPhone or an iPad to use as the input.
Or a Magic Trackpad, which they sell for $60.
Okay, so then you take the entry on that from $99, which everybody agrees is a great price, right? Roku, you know.
I'm just disappointed. Here's why I'm disappointed. No, you're right. I completely agree with you. It's logistically difficult, but I would have loved. I could have bought a Hulu TV and put Hulu Plus on there. I mean, talk about a la carte, Robert. You're talking about now. I can put, HBO wants to make a True Blood app. I buy True Blood that way, right? Wouldn't that be the best way to do it?
I agree. I think one of the big holdups for quite a few people, at least, will be sports content and premium sports content.
Okay, look, live stuff.
ESPN and Speed Channel and some of the other stuff that you can only get BBC and only America. Watch through paid subscriptions through your cable
or
satellite
but let me
provider.
Tell you something. I watched the World Cup. I was at a conference. I couldn't watch a TV. I, like a lot of other people, bought, what was it, the Flow TV? No, Mobi.
Mobi
I bought
TV.
Mobi.
I watched World Cup games on my iPhone. It was awesome.
Yes! Yes, that's the true a la carte experience, and that was a sporting event. Now, admittedly, it wasn't the largest screen ever, but if you attach that to, an Apple TV.
But they're also streaming they were streaming that stuff on ESPN 360 or whatever. They changed it to ESPN
El Ocho.
El Ocho. But, I mean, if you do MLB TV and you pay for that, I mean, I think ultimately you'll be able to watch anything you want via some kind of internet-connected device to your television.
The content creators like it because, like, if you're the Academy Awards, you get direct revenue from the people watching the show. You might, the advertisers know exactly how many people are watching it, so you can charge it better.
I mean, the biggest impediment is tradition and, all of the contracts with all of the cable companies.
Well, that's who hates this, right? Because they're basically becoming bits providers. They no longer sell premium content. Anyway, do you think Google TV will become that now that Apple has said, well, we're not going to do that? Is that where Google...
Well, I mean, right now, there's a really great article.
Sorry, I just drank some sun drop, and it's
talking faster.
It's gone right to my head.
North Carolina sunshine and a lot of corn syrup in every sip of sun drop.
You thought Mountain Dew was hot, man. This is good stuff, man. I love that, man. I just need some barbecue, man. I'll be happy. I'll be really happy.
Sparkling.
What did they put in there?
I don't know.
Happiness, John. It's good. It's happiness. But it's like one of the things I think it was All Things D said was the real winner. Apple TV proves the real winner right now in the battle for the living room is Netflix because everybody is Netflix.
You got to have Netflix.
You know, Blu-ray players are doing Netflix.
Yep.
Devices, appliances are doing Netflix. Set-top boxes are doing
Netflix.
But
that just proves Robert's point, the a la carte point. That's a la carte, isn't it?
Yep. It's a la carte, but we need, somebody with enough money and clout and time to make a la carte effective. The interesting thing about Google versus
Netflix. Is Google
Netflix,
big enough?
Google is big enough. Google is big enough that they're starting a music service ostensibly to compete with iTunes. It's supposed to be out by the end of this year. They're hiring the managers at this point like the person responsible. But the idea that they built the Google TV box, the idea is that it's going to sit in between your cable box, your DirecTV box, or it's going to be your Dish Network box and your TV.
How many boxes are we going to have?
Well, that's why
I own like seven at this point.
That's why apps are so important because one box that supports apps, you add the apps you want. It's all one
box.
But
that's the same thing. Do I care if you're like, I want everything to be on iOS because Steve can do anything.
No. Actually, I just want somebody to do it.
What if Google TV allowed me to buy my television shows?
That'd
by
be fine.
Just clicking on a button.
Then it's
or subscribe
Google TV.
To ESPN for $24
a
month.
What I'm saying is, I think Apple dropped the ball, and Google now has an opportunity to do this very thing.
Unless Apple's trying to negotiate deals directly with all of the content.
That's a
producers.
Mistake.
Or if they need one of those weird third parties, I've got to find some cable company in Timbuktu that has a weird hole in their license that'll allow me to
broadcast.
No.
This is a mistake.
Stuff.
All Apple has to do is put the platform out there. It's about platforms. And this is what Microsoft learned. You provide the platform, and you let people write to the platform. Apple gets 30% of every subscription of everything. So if you say, here's the platform, HBO, you want to make a True Blood app? Fine. Hulu, you want to do Hulu Plus? Fine. You want to MLB, you want to do a baseball app? Fine. You get 30% because that's how it works.
Right.
And they don't have to make a deal with anybody.
So it's just like There's a Roku box then.
It's a Roku box, universal Roku box.
Universal. I think the set-top boxes themselves are really a stopgap measure for the time being until everyone owns a TV that's essentially a full-blown computer where you have a selection of applications that you can choose from anybody.
Well isn't Sony going to do that with Google TV? And Samsung made some noise that they may be doing.
Totally.
Yeah.
Samsung had a whole application developers day about 2 weeks ago in San Francisco.
Right.
And that was phenomenally eye-opening in terms of what they really want to do in terms of... Essentially, there is a store now with your TV, just like you have with your smartphone.
Here's why it doesn't. Here's why here's their pitfall is if there's a Sony way of doing it and a Samsung way of doing it and a Vizio way of doing it, that's not going to work.
Right.
That's why Google has to step in, or Apple, or somebody has stepped in and said, "Here's the platform. Right to this platform, it'll work on all the TVs."
So now, but there's not going to be one. There's not going to be one. I mean, right now you've got Comcast competing with DirecTV, competing with whoever else, and you're going to have. You're going to have your set-top boxes competing with your Rokus and your Boxies and your Apple TVs and your Google TVs, and there's going to be at least a couple of players, and hopefully there's a compatibility or some kind of a standard so that you know you can make universal binaries of your darn stuff to work other places. That's why Netflix is available through the PS3, through the Wii, through the Roku, through Boxy, through all of that. And same with, you know, you want TWiT to be available and all that stuff, and we want Revision 3 to be available
Well,
and all
that's
that stuff.
Why we're excited about it, isn't it? Because it puts us on a parity.
Yeah, and you've got different models also. For us,
and
it's like we want to be available for free everywhere, people like TWiT and Revision 3. But then you've got, you know, people like HBO who can also get in the same game and have apps available different places, but you'll have to subscribe for it, which people will do.
So why isn't this happening?
Because nobody's built the box that everybody's going to have or created the platform.
It doesn't have to be the box. It has to be the platform.
Okay,
it has to be the
what I'm saying is nobody's also figured out the platform that everyone will write to, because Samsung and Sony and LG and, you know, umpteen other companies, they're all in competition with each other.
These are the same morons who gave us HD DVD versus Blu-ray, VHS versus Beta. Are we going down that same road?
We're already there, dude.
Oh, it sucks. That just sucks.
But you could see something, though, like Android or some open platform becoming the basis for all of these devices, though. And that helps alleviate the whole issue of having different platforms to develop for if you're the content owner or you want to make one of these apps. I got to choose between whether I develop for a Sony TV or a Samsung box or a Roku box or what have you.
I think that's what Google's plan is. That's why the Android is open source. You can use it for free, right?
And it's all going to end up in the TV. No more of these stupid boxes.
Yeah, if you want.
Well, you know what? I don't actually mind the box because, you know, say
it's cheaper to buy a new box
than a new TV.
I prefer the box myself, yeah. And it's easier. If the box supports apps, all the upgrade is done in software.
But the Blu-ray box, you know, your Blu-ray player.
It could be in the Blu-ray player.
Supports app. Your television.
I think
though
physical
apps.
Media is dead, so I don't think people should be buying Blu-ray players at this point.
I would like to have an argument with you about that.
Well, if you have any Blu-rays you don't want, Leo, just get
I love my Blu-ray. No, I love my Blu-rays, but that's another niche content play.
You mean like your LaserDisc player?
It's a niche content play that's showing up in 7-Elevens and supermarkets.
Physical media is dead.
Online. No,
physical media is dead.
The thing is, physical media is dead for people who can afford the broadband access, who can afford the rest of the technology.
No, because I can't afford broadband access, but the HD movies on
that's
iTunes
what I just
look
said.
Awful. You're talking about the file size for 1080p. When they can afford to deliver 1080p file sizes.
I think physical media will only be dead when a majority of people who I can, you know.
Is it not true that people don't buy Blu-rays because they think DVDs look good enough?
2 years ago, maybe. At this point, the penetration on HDTVs, 1080p HDTVs, is vastly higher. It's jumped up like, what was it, Robert? Like 70%.
They got the TVs, but are they buying the Blu-ray?
They are buying the Blu-rays. All right. Blu-ray sales.
Don't you think this is all dependent on the fact that you can get a Blu-ray disc player now for like $135 bucks?
Yeah, it had to be cheap.
Or totally. Less?
Yeah.
I mean, and those same players will still play a DVD, too. So when people go out to buy a new disc player, period... You know, that same box, play your CD, DVD, Blu-ray, whatever. So,
okay, we'll see.
Although, I'll ask a question. When are we going to get a Blu-ray writer that we can use it in the home?
What's holding that up?
We already have them.
That's going to be a big topic.
They're really expensive.
This week at CEDIA, and then coming up at CES, you're going to see TVs with those integrated especially with the new BDXL format. You're actually going to see a couple TVs that will offer a Blu-ray recorder built into the TV itself that you can just drop the disc into, and that gives you a chunk of storage. Or you'll be able to hook up your own external hard drives to these TVs as well and use them as like a DVR style, just built in. Instead of having the hard drive in the TV, it's just you can add your own storage if you want that functionality.
Will there be any kind of content lock for certain programs or channels that will not let you?
I'm sure it'll be a very secure storage platform in terms of that hard drive will likely be paired with that television set.
But I mean, that, like a burnable Blu-ray disc, would you be able to take it, you know, the finished product and drop it in?
Well, it depends on which platform, because a bunch of the DVR Blu-ray burners that are out in Japan, they just released ones for the new the Blu-ray HDX format. Is that XL? The new 100 XL format?
Yeah,
you know, 128 gigabyte Blu-rays, but that's also almost all of them are Japan only.
So this is why HD Nation is such a good idea for a show.
Yeah, and which why you should watch on a weekly basis.
Absolutely, I do.
HDNation or HDNation.tv for the best in home theater and high-definition content.
Justin Bieber, we have learned.
Love that show.
Justin Bieber, we have learned, has his own servers in the Twitter server closet. More than one. Dedicated
stud.
Wait, so does he?
I was kind of hoping you said Justin Bieber has been called home and Bob Marley is back.
I'm a member of that group on Facebook.
The one time I've been on Facebook in the last 3 months, and the thing that pops up at the top of the page is Leo Laporte is a fan of Justin Bieber. I'm like, what?
No, there's
Justin
more.
Justin Bieber, you know, going away. And
are you
going
to sport
Bob
a Bieber
Marley
cut
coming back
in the next show?
Yeah, I might. No, I've got nothing against the kid. In fact, I don't even know what his music sounds like.
I do. Sounds terrible.
As he swims in his kiddie pool full of $100 bills.
How do you know? How do you know? What is it, John? Did you?
He was on the Saturday Night Live show. Sang a couple songs. He's off key.
John's the guy that still watches Saturday Night Live.
He's personally. Wow, talk about institution. It was an accident.
I'm glad there was
Whatever
somebody.
Whatever the case is, no wonder I'm grumpy. You guys are giving nothing but grief. So anyway, he's got a bunch of dancers behind him. The whole show is kind of creepy, actually, to be honest about
it. The episode or just his
music? Very good at all.
That's interesting. Well, but kids love him.
Maybe he's going through puberty and his voice is beginning to crack.
But kids love him.
Girls love him. Is he going to go to the next letter? B?
B.
B.
C. D. D. Burr.
So this is why it's good, because he's heavily produced.
Yeah. Anybody could say, I could sound good if I had that kind of production in auto-tune.
I hate auto-tune.
And then there was the slow motion version of the Bieber song that went viral.
What? The slow mo? Oh, yeah. Wasn't that funny?
That was awesome.
It was weird.
It sounded like Enya or something.
Yeah, it was creepy.
I didn't realize he was on with Tina Fey. Like,
Justin Enya?
Sketches with Tina Fey.
Yeah, that's what I was watching. I wanted to see Tina Fey.
Tina Fey.
You like
His
Tina
smile
Fey?
Is like watching a baby bunny
funny.
Sniff a tiny
You
flower.
Like her beyond awesome. Her funny?
What do you mean? What does that mean exactly?
Is Tina Fey a hottie?
What does that mean exactly? So this is how I get
I'm asking the grump.
This is how I get our videos banned on YouTube, by the way, is doing stuff like playing this clip from Saturday Night. Wait, shut up. It's just an ad. I don't want to see the ad.
It's just an ad.
It's just an ad.
Just an ad.
Hey, Yoshi, you know, you're the guy who built the amazing, incredible gaming rig with 18 different gaming things in it. I would think at home, your home theater setup is like, you got it down.
It's not bad. We've got two right now.
Do you?
We've got the 60 and the 50.
60 and the 50. That's 110 total.
Yeah, but I wish it worked that way.
Do you watch cable or do you listen? Or do you watch a la carte?
Well, we do DirecTV for our main service because a lot of stuff's not available. But we do Netflix on the Wii, which Cruz watches all his little cartoons on there.
I love Netflix.
And, well, actually, I do more of that than anything.
Okay, John, I'll give it to you. I'll give it to you.
Dude, life is good for Justin.
John's the host of the incredible Swanky Geeks program, which you can catch every Wednesday.
I'm looking good there.
Awesome.
With Fabio C. Dvorak. Wow, that's attractive. Thank
Great
you.
Great tone.
Good tone, John. You've been working out a lot.
Two giant meat pillows.
Dud muffin.
If you want to know more about John, there's one place only to go, and that is channeldvorak.com. That's the place where you could find swanky geeks, the tech, what is it, nerd?
Tech hippie, the tech grouch, the noagendashow.com, and whatever.
Whatever.
Lots of things going on.
And whatever. Hey, you know what I'm
whatever.
You know what I'm excited about? Just before we go, I was going to start to wrap up, but then I forgot to mention this. Galaxy S Tab, the new Samsung tablet, they got it on Verizon, AT&T, and Sprint. It's going to come out September 16th, 7-inch tablet running Android. Have you seen this? Mm-mm. This looks very sweet, and they got it on three big carriers.
Who's going for this product? Like,
where is it? Everybody wants to see it, huh? I don't know. I will buy one right away.
You buy everything you right away.
Okay. I happen to like my Android.
What's it going to cost?
$200 to $300 subsidized.
So with a 2-year. So basically, it's
you'll be buying a contract because it's 3G. Look, here's a stunning video to get you excited about it. So 7 inches. So it's a little bigger than the Streak, but a little smaller than the iPad.
It looks like a really lengthy iPhone, rather than
but it's not a phone.
Like a giant phone.
It's not a phone though, so it's just a tablet.
It's not a phone. It's a tablet, but it can make phone
calls.
You
know, isn't that roughly the same size as the Newton?
Not the same size as the Evo.
No, it's smaller than the Evo. I have a Droid X. I like the 4-inch screen, but I think a 7-inch. Now this is kind of stupid. That's the augmented reality browser. I can
this video makes it look like he's going to walk into the middle of the street and get hit by a car because he's still staring at the phone.
He's looking at the thing. It's a little scary, isn't it?
And, you know, if you look up, buddy, you know where you are.
Yeah. No. It's much better to interact with your device and see where you are.
Oh, yeah. Heaven forbid I can actually see these objects. I'll look at them through here.
Oh, all right.
You can pretty much do that with Street View, by the way. Street View on your phone.
I agree.
And you can just walk down the street and stare at your phone, and you're basically looking at what's out there. Sans the cars in the way.
You know what's so creepy is when, like, you're in front of somewhere, and then you're looking at it on your computer, and then you look up, and it's the same place.
Deja vu?
Yoshi, thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate it. It's so great to hear from you. Glad you're doing well.
Yeah, it's fun. But sorry I was driving the whole time and not as interactive.
No. You were driving? You got back in the car and started driving?
I would.
Well, yeah.
He wants to get back to Hotlanta. Well, it's great.
I just don't like driving at night too much.
It's so great to talk to you. Say, give our best to Carrie and Cruz. And the next time you're in Northern California, please stop in. We'd love to see you.
Definitely.
Thank you, Yoshi.
Thank you.
I mean, it's so great. I've been trying to get Yoshi on this show for 4 years. 4 years.
Surprised you even got a hold of him.
Well, thanks to Eileen. She's a good producer. See how much better this show is with somebody producing it? Robert Heron and Patrick Norton together do HD Nation, a great show.
Thank you.
It's great to see you again, Robert. I haven't seen you in ages, but don't be a stranger. I love hearing from you.
Always a pleasure, Leo.
Thanks so much. Thank you. You can catch Patrick also at techzilla.com. He and Roger Chang. See, there's all this interlinking
incestuousness.
And Veronica Belmont.
And the lovely Veronica Belmont. Do you think I could ever lure her to the Twit Cottage?
We would. I would do something horrible.
First of all, it sounds really creepy when you say it that way. Second of all, that's very creepy.
Let me lure her to the cottage.
Very, very creepy.
If you steal my co-host, I will epoxy every entrance
I won't steal
to this
your
building
co-host.
Shut.
I won't steal your. I swear to you.
We'll make you sit and watch nothing but Justin Bieber music videos.
JohnCDvorak.org/blog/channeldvorak. It's great to have you on once again. Thank you for joining us. I appreciate it. You got to come up and drink the Leoville.
Yes, we're going to do that in the next few weeks.
All right. Otherwise, I do have Sun Drop Pop just for you.
I'll avoid that like the plague.
The green.
What the hell is in that soda?
I don't know. It's good.
Well, it's just water and
carbonated water, high fructose corn syrup. That's all.
Citric acid's based, kind of like a Mountain Dew.
Ooh, that's what we need, more high fructose corn syrup.
We need to justify corn subsidies somehow.
Lysine, baby. It's all about the lysine. I'm Leo Laporte. We invite you to stay tuned. Roger Chang and Tom Merida coming up with East Meets West. Tom, of course, does our daily news show, TNT. If you want to hear the news in a fresh format, in a stylish fresh format, tune in every Monday through Friday at 5:30 Eastern, 2:30 Pacific at live.twit.tv. For those of you living outside the U.S., that's 2230 UTC for Tom and the gang. I'm Leo Laporte. I said that.
Yes.
You're Patrick Norton.
Yes.
You're Roger Chang.
I am.
Robert Heron. David Prager, also at Revision 3. I knew there was somebody I left out. Thank you for being here, David. Another twit is in the can. Potted you out. I potted you up by accident. I thought it was Yoshi.
Oh.
Sorry.
It's right when I was telling you I was going to Poshy's baby shower.
Oh.
She wanted me to tell you hi. Because I said I'm trying to scoot out of twit so I can go to her. I convinced her to invite guys to the baby shower, so I have to go.
Oh, how exciting.
Poshy. At Poshy on Twitter, I think.
At Poshy. Yeah. Well, give her our best.
Hey, Roger.
Yes.
Thank you.
I'll hang up on you guys. Truly. On Skype. Take care.
I hope I wasn't too grouchy.
You were great. You were the usual. That's what we look for you. From
I think
you.
I was a little over grouchy today.
Yeah, no, I like it when you're fiery like that.
Feisty.
The feisty John C.
Is there any other way he comes?
Well, sometimes he's a little pussycat. And sometimes he's just a little pussy.
Brimstone.
Jeez.
Hey!
Bye! Bye!